Hi. Yeah. So today I'm going to talk to you about identifying synthetic lethals in metabolic networks. So what are synthetic lethals? So synthetic lethal gene or reaction sets are sets of genes or reactions where only the joint removal of all genes abolishes growth. So if you look at this example, so when you remove either the gene PQR or the gene ABC, the cell still survives. But when you remove both of them, the cell can no longer live. And the concept of synthetic lethality can be extended to higher orders like triple gene deletions and so on. So when you remove A, B, B, C, or C, A, there is no impact on the phenotype, but when you remove all of A, B, C, then the cell can no longer grow. Why do we identify synthetic lethals? They find applications in understanding gene function and functional associations. Combinatorial drug targets against pathogens because it's much more difficult to evolve resistance against multiple targets, and also in cancer therapy for synthetic lethals and so on. How do we identify synthetic lethals? Experimentally, there are many techniques such as yeast synthetic genetic arrays, but they're expensive and difficult to perform. The alternative is to go in for computational approaches, and there are approaches which have built on flux balance analysis. So what is flux balance analysis? I think it's the right city to be talking about it, given a lot of work is being done at UCSD. So it's an effective constraint-based method for studying genome-scale metabolic networks. So the mass balance in a system of reactions can be represented in terms of linear equations involving reaction fluxes. So the variables in question here are the reaction fluxes, and the goal is to find a set of fluxes which are admissible in a system which satisfy all the mass and thermodynamic constraints. These systems are typically underdetermined, so we have to typically enforce an objective function to find one solution to the problem, and it turns out to be a nice linear programming problem and comes down to something like maximizing the biomass such that a set of mass balance constraints are satisfied and some bounds on the reaction fluxes are also satisfied. So here M is the set of metabolites and J is the set of reactions. FBA has since been extended to study perturbations, including synthetic lethals, and it does reasonably well. So how it works is you do the same thing, but you add additional constraints saying a particular set of reaction or a particular reaction has been now pinned to zero. And what is the new? Can the cell continue to grow? Can it produce a biomass flux despite the deletion of XYZ genes? So what are the ways to identify synthetic lethals? So one of them is, of course, brute force or exhaustive enumeration. This has been done in the past. So the idea is you solve one optimization problem to identify a set of, to check if a particular deletion is lethal or not. So this is easy in case of single lethals, but when you're talking about double, or more importantly, triple lethals, you're talking about a combinatorial explosion of possibilities for an organism with just 1,000 genes, looking at something like 170 million simulations. And even at, say, a few hundred milliseconds per simulation, this takes quite a long while. And it also becomes infeasible in case of larger organisms like yeast and so on. There has been another approach known as SL Finder from Maranas's group. It's a very elegant way to pose this problem as a bi-level mixed integer linear programming problem. And they've used this in the past to identify synthetic lethal double and triple reaction deletions in E. coli. But the issue here is that the MILP problems become incrementally difficult to solve because it involves a concept called integer cuts. So the first deletion, first triple gene deletion is easy to find, but towards the end, it takes much longer time to find the deletions, and the whole computation takes about a week, which is not very trivial. And the gene deletions are also difficult to infer from reaction deletions. This is something that people haven't tackled in the past. So the question we are asking here is there a way to surmount the complexity of either the brute force enumeration or the bilevel MILP through a different method? And that is what we seek to do here with a method called FAST-SL. SL stands for synthetic lethals. So what we do is we extensively prune the search space for synthetic lethals, and then exhaustively iterate through the remaining much fewer combinations that remain. and we successively compute three sets, the set of synthetic single lethal reactions, JSL, the set of double lethal reactions, which belongs to J cross J, because we have a pair of reactions, and then a set of triple lethal reactions, which belongs to J cross J cross J. The main idea here is we use FBA to compute a flux distribution corresponding to maximum growth rate, at the same time minimizing the number of fluxes being used, or to basically trying to compute a very sparse solution to the linear program. This involves, mathematically, this involves minimizing the L1 norm of the flux vector. So we have applied FastSL to identify synthetic lethals in E. coli, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and Salmonella. So the minimum norm formulation goes like this. So we minimize the sum of the flux vector such that your regular FBA constraints are obeyed, and in addition, it also sustains the maximum growth identified by the FBA formulation. So we have a set of reactions J, and only a small subset of these reactions, JNZ, admit a flux during in this sparse solution. How does this help cut down the search space? So if a reaction J carries zero flux in the minimal norm solution, which is constrained already to support growth, it cannot be lethal. So the idea is we do not need to look in outside JNZ to identify single lethal reactions. So the set, there is no single lethal reaction outside JNZ, or the set of all single lethals is contained within JNZ. So this is a reasonable saving in one dimension, that is to identify single lethal reactions. And the savings are multiplied when we go to double deletions. So consider this matrix. So consists as a two-dimensional space of reactions. So every point in this space represents a pair of reactions. So this is J cross J, and this reaction is actually this figure is drawn to scale for E. coli. So JSL here is the single lethals, and then JNZ is this part, which is the non-zero reactions in the minimal norm formulation. So if a pair of reactions IJ carry zero flux in the minimal norm solution, they cannot form a synthetic lethal pair, because you can drive them to zero and still support growth, which means they are not essential for growth, or they don't form a synthetic lethal pair, which means this whole area can be eliminated. And this area of JSL, the blue area, can also be eliminated because they're single lethals already, and deleting an additional gene is not going to affect your phenotype, which means all the synthetic lethal pairs lie in this narrow red region. And this represents a significant saving in terms of the search space. And we can actually make further gains by reapplying the minimal norm formulation. I won't get into the details, but if you're interested, you're welcome to see our poster. And this is the final picture. So for single gene deletions, we have a modest saving of we do it in about 1/6 of the time. But as we go to higher orders, let's look at triple gene deletions. In the exhaustive scenario, we need to do almost 1 billion simulations, whereas we end up, in our case, doing only 200,000 simulations, and our results agree exactly with exhaustive enumeration. We also carried out exhaustive enumeration, even though we can essentially prove that this technique works. So in about 2.5 hours, we are able to analyze all possible triple gene deletions in E. coli. So what is the purpose? So synthetic lethals can illustrate complex metabolic dependencies which are not otherwise easily understood. For example, there are genes from different pathways that coexist in a single synthetic lethal set. For example, we have ATP synthase, cytochrome D ubiquinol oxidase, and G3P dehydrogenase. They perhaps bring about their effect by disabling both oxidative and substrate level phosphorylation. And similarly, you have enolase, PEP synthase, and succinate dehydrogenase, having a kind of complex effect on finally disabling oxidative phosphorylation. So we also studied combinatorial drug targets in the two pathogenic organisms we are concerned with, Mycobacterium tuberculosis and Salmonella. So we find that even though we have 170 million simulations that to look at. Only a few of them give rise to combinatorial lethal deletions. So this reemphasizes the robust nature of metabolic networks in both tuberculosis and salmonella. So we find that about 28 triplets and 20 doublets in Mycobacterium tuberculosis have no homologs in human. And similarly, 21 triplets and 39 doublets, this is a small number out of the very large number that you start with, have no homologs again in a human. So some of these may be interesting drug targets. As far as the limitations of our approach are concerned, we only look at through the metabolic lens. So the metabolic models considered here do not account for regulation or other functions, and we can identify synthetic lethals only in metabolism, and any inadequacies or gaps in the metabolic model will be carried over. So if some isozymes haven't been characterized yet, and any gaps in existing knowledge, but perhaps we can address them using the results of this, wherein we iterate on the model to converge to the reality. So to summarize, synthetic lethals are difficult to identify computationally because you have a combinatorial explosion of possibilities. But what we do is we circumvent the complexities of previous approaches by massively reducing the search space for synthetic lethals using the minimal norm solution for FBA. And for E. coli, we reduce the search space by about 4,000-fold. And even comparison to the best method that's available today, which takes about a week, we are able to solve it in a few hours. So this can greatly enable the calculation, the computation of synthetic lethals to study and compare across different organisms and so on. And the other thing is we rigorously evaluate gene deletions rather than infer them from reaction deletions. If you want further details, I can talk to you by my poster. And importantly, despite cutting down on all the time, our results agree exactly with exhaustive enumeration. And our approach finds applications in identifying functional associations and combinatorial drug targets. And our routine is available for download online. It's implemented for the Cobra toolbox in MATLAB, and it's available freely. And to acknowledge Aditya as the master student who did most of the work that I presented here, and my other co-author is Dr. Shankar Balachandran. And we did use a lot of high-performance computing to validate our results using exhaustive enumeration. And yeah, this is the funding. So if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them and also discuss by our poster. Thank you.
Hi, nice talk. As I understand, the prediction from flux balance analysis depends on what objective function that you use. For microbes, yes, I think biomass optimization would be interesting. Is an interesting objective function. How about for mammalian cells? What do you think would be a good objective function? Thank you.
Yeah, that's a very good question, and I think it's still a very open question up for debate. So people have again tried to use some sort of biomass again for mammalian cells, but it's still not very convincing. I think the FBA approach works very nicely for smaller organisms, and I think even yeast is okay. But the moment you step into the domain of mammalian cells, it gets a lot more difficult to evaluate. For example, if you're looking at evaluating synthetic lethals in human, which is, I think, a very interesting problem cancer-wise, the metabolic model is there, but I don't think we yet have the right objective function to analyze it.
So do you have plans to do some extensive experimental validation of these predictions?
Well, I think there are already a bit of experimental data, and there are experimental data that we can use to validate. So we do not yet have plans to do experimental validation on our own, but I think there's a lot of data lying around.
A good topic for next green challenge?
Of course.
All right. So Aurelien Rix is the next speaker. And.